ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। हरे कृष्ण, welcome to our daily discussions on Krishna's pastimes. Yesterday we have seen how Krishna, Balaram and the Gopas had a tour in the city of Mathura, and we have seen how Krishna has delivered a washerman in his tour. A washerman became so arrogant that when Krishna requested the washerman to give him some clothes, the washerman arrogantly replied that you are all forest people, you are mountain wanderers, you are uncivilized villagers. How dare you are requesting for the clothes of the king? These are meant for the king. If you ask like this, the soldiers of the king will punish you, will arrest you, will loot you and will kill you. So you are not supposed to ask like this, and you are not qualified, you are unfit to wear this kind of royal clothes. The washerman arrogantly replied like this, Krishna separated the washerman's head with his fingertips, and Krishna has liberated that washerman. And moving ahead, Krishna also reciprocated with the pure love and devotion of a weaver who lovingly offered cloth ornaments to Krishna and Balaram. And further moving ahead, Krishna personally went to the house of a florist named Sudama. And Sudama offered beautiful garlands to Krishna, Balaram and all the Gopas, and Krishna became so ecstatic and very pleased to bestow benedictions upon Sudama. And Sudama asked that, my dear Krishna, I want pure unflinching devotion unto you, and I want friendships with all the devotees, and I also want compassion towards common living entities. These are my three desires. And Krishna has fulfilled all the three desires of Sudama florist. And yesterday we have also discussed the past lives of all these three personalities, and how Krishna, when he was touring the Mathura city, he was given dresses. Actually, he has taken dresses from the washerman, and he was given cloth ornaments by the weaver, and he was also offered garlands by florist Sudama. Now Krishna is being dressed and decorated as he is traveling on the streets of Mathura, and the next item in his dressing is some ointments, some fragrant scents. So as Krishna, Balaram and all the Gopas were moving ahead in their tour of Mathura city, they came upon a woman who was a hunchbacked woman. And she came upon Krishna and Balaram, and she was carrying some ointments. She was carrying some sandalwood pulp and some very fragrant substances that when they're applied on the body, so the body becomes very fragrant and cooling. So Krishna saw this hunchback woman. Her name was Trivakra, because her body was bent at three places. Krishna's body is also bent at three places, but Krishna is called Tribhanga. Shyamam Tribhanga Lalitam. So Krishna is called Tribhanga. His bent, the bends on his body are very enchanting to look at. But Trivakra was also bent, but she was a hunchbacked lady. She was not very beautiful to look at. She had a beautiful face, but she did not have a beautiful body. So she was carrying ointments. And although she was looking little ugly from an external sense, she was very expert in making sandalwood pulp and ointments, that Kamsa likes her ointments very specifically. And because Kubja was not looking very appealing to the eyes, so Kamsa never was attracted to her beauty, although it's natural for Kshatriyas or kings to maintain some connections with even servant maids also. But Trivakra was pure. Trivakra was untouched by Kamsa because of her ugliness. So actually Trivakra was meant to become a lover of Krishna. So Krishna, Balaram and all the gopas were passing on the street, and they came upon this hunchbacked woman named Trivakra. And Krishna and Balaram asked, Krishna asked that, who are you? Oh, Katvam Varoru Etad Henu Lepanam Hanu Lepanam. You are taking this Anulepa, you are taking all these ointments and sandalwood pulp. So who are you? And Krishna asked about the identity of this Trivakra. And she said that my name is Kubja. My name is Trivakra. She is also called Kubja. She is also called Trivakra. So my name is Kubja and I am the maid servant of King Kamsa. And my duty is to make the special ointments and sandalwood pulp. And now I am going to Kamsa's palace to offer him all these things. Then Krishna and Balaram, Krishna specifically, very sweetly asked Trivakra, can you please give us also some ointments? So we are also desirous of using these ointments on our body. Can you please offer us? So just now Krishna has been dressed so nicely from the dresses taken from washerman. And he was also offered beautiful ornaments, cloth ornaments made by the weaver. And he was also offered garlands by florist Sudama. Now the next item is the sandalwood pulp and other ointments, fragrant substances that were in the hands of Trivakra. So Krishna asked like this, and Trivakra, without any fear of Kamsa, she was spontaneously attracted to the charming form of Krishna, and she offered all these ointments to Krishna and Balaram also. She has taken profuse quantities of this ointment and applied on the face and on the shoulders and on the chest of Krishna and Balaram. And she has also made some very nice paintings and patterns on the body of Krishna with this colorful ointments. Thus Krishna was so beautifully decorated even while he was traveling on the street. And Trivakra was spontaneously attracted to Krishna. Although she was doing all the services to Krishna publicly, it was on the street, it was not in private. Trivakra did not even say, Kubja did not say that, Krishna, I would like to give you these ointments, but I am very fearful of Kamsa, or can you please come to a secret place so that I can offer you these ointments without anyone seeing. She did not say anything like that. So Trivakra was naturally and spontaneously so attracted to Krishna that she did not have any hesitation to offer these ointments to Krishna, although she was doing it publicly. So many people were watching this fun, but Kubja did not have any fear. So this is this kind of fearless, spontaneous, loving devotion unto Krishna and service attitude unto Krishna is the natural characteristic of a devotee. And this Trivakra or Kubja became naturally a devotee of Krishna, spontaneously. And she offered everything to Krishna. And although she had such great devotion, her body was deformed. And in reciprocation with her natural, spontaneous service attitude that she had, and the service that she had specifically rendered to Krishna and Balaram, Krishna wanted to make her beautiful. She was looking ugly because of her hunchback. So Krishna wanted to straighten her back and make her so beautiful. Exquisitely beautiful. So this is the reciprocation of Krishna when somebody offers loving service to Krishna. By offering something to Krishna, we are never losers. We will only get benefit. Not only externally, the ultimate spiritual benefit that we are going to get is Krishna's mercy, by which Krishna can take us back home, back to Godhead also, to his eternal abode also. Thus Krishna wanted to reciprocate with her devotion. And the acharyas explain that this Trivakra or Kubja represents Mother Earth. Now, in this material world, this Kali Yuga is characterized by very bad qualities. So, Trivakra's hunchback represents the poor fallen condition of Krishna, of Earth, Mother Earth. And Krishna's straightening the back of Trivakra represents that Krishna will reduce the burden of the earth. Earlier when Krishna went and when Mother Earth, before the appearance of Krishna, Mother Earth went to Brahmaji, and all the demigods and Mother Earth accompanied Brahma to the shore of Milk Ocean, and Brahma offered prayers to the Supreme Lord, requesting him to descend on the earthly planet to reduce her burden. Mother Earth was overburdened by so many demoniac rulers, selfish rulers, materialistic kings who were only maintaining big military forces only to torment people. They were not righteous. They were not following the course of Dharma. So that was all burden on Mother Earth. So Trivakra, or the hunchback of this Trivakra or Kubja, represents the piteous condition of Mother Earth. And now Krishna is going to straighten her back. That shows that Krishna is going to reduce the burden of earth. Krishna is going to relieve the earth of all these demoniac personalities. So Krishna already relieved the earth from so many demons while he was staying in Vrindavan. Now he has shifted to Mathura. Henceforth, Krishna is going to focus on so many demons like Jarasandha, demoniac personality, and eventually in Kurukshetra war, through his devotees, the Pandavas, Krishna is going to do mass killing of unscrupulous, materialistic, selfish, demoniac personalities. So Krishna is straightening the back of Kubja, represents Krishna's reducing the burden of earth. So how did Krishna do that? How did Krishna accomplish that? Krishna kept his foot on the legs, on the feet of Trivakra, and he took his two fingers, the middle finger and the index finger, and kept below her chin. And Krishna used his left hand to support her back, and then he straightened the back of Trivakra by just pulling her. So he just supported her legs with his own feet, and then he did like this. So Trivakra became very straight. Not only her back has become straight, Trivakra also looked exquisitely beautiful. She was so charming, and her face was gorgeous, and everybody was wondering. Right in the street, in front of everyone, Krishna has transformed Trivakra into a very beautiful woman, and everyone was astonished to see this transformation in the body of Trivakra, and they all praised Krishna. So in this way, Krishna has delivered Trivakra, and this Trivakra was doing the activity of Sairendri, or a maid servant, and she says that I am a dasi of Kamsa, and I am a servant of Kamsa, and Kamsa likes me only for the ointments that I make. Kamsa was so cruel and heinous that he would take the service from his servants, but he wouldn't give them love and affection or reciprocation. So this is the nature of demoniac rulers or demoniac leaders. So this Trivakra was attracted to Krishna's Rupa Peshala Madhurya. She spontaneously said that these ointments which I have made for Kamsa are actually meant to be utilized by a very beautiful personality like you. These ointments may not look very good on Kamsa. They will look good on a beautiful personality like you, O Krishna. She says, Rupa Peshala Madhurya Hasitalapa Vikshitaihi. Her mind was overwhelmed with Krishna's Rupa Peshala Madhurya. Rupa means Krishna's beauty, and Peshala, his charm, Madhurya, his sweetness. All these things in Krishna very, very much attracted the heart of Trivakra, and she naturally felt that I should serve Krishna. Even though Kamsa may cause some harm to me, I don't care. She just gave up her fear of Kamsa. So she became spontaneously fearless. And Krishna has reciprocated with her devotion. So to enhance Krishna's beauty, already Krishna is beautiful, but if Krishna has applied these ointments and some patterns and colorful patterns on his body, and some paintings and the dots that we put on Krishna's face, that will make the darshan of Krishna so appealing. So Trivakra did that special service to Krishna. So for that, Krishna made Trivakra beautiful. So when we render service to Krishna, when we decorate Krishna, we being the servants of Krishna, children of Krishna, reflections of Krishna, we will also be beautified. Our beauty is there in beautifying Krishna. We will be decorated when we decorate Krishna. So we may not be literally decorated or become beautiful like Trivakra, but the beauty of a devotee is in one's service to Krishna, not just decorating oneself with all kinds of cosmetics. So all cosmetics are meant to be offered to Krishna. So here she became exquisitely beautiful that she became like best of women. Suta Goswami, Sukadeva Goswami says, Tato rupa gunau darya sampanna praha keshavam uttariyantam akrishya smayanti jata hrishaya. Spontaneously, earlier Kubja was attracted to Krishna to offer him ointments. But when Krishna made her so beautiful, very young and beautiful, she was again spontaneously attracted with conjugal feelings towards Krishna. She immediately wanted to serve Krishna in a conjugal mood and enjoy with Krishna. So she requested Krishna by holding his cloth. He just caught the uttari of Krishna and then pulled Krishna and says, Krishna, please come to my house. I am overwhelmed with an irresistible and uncontrollable desire to serve you at my home. Can you please come to my home? Then Krishna very jokingly he said, yes, yes, people like you, very good hosts like you, are the real shelters for travelers like us. So we will definitely come to your house. So like that, Krishna kind of made her conjugal proposal look like a joke. So thus Krishna enhanced some jovial mood and hasya rasa in the whole assembly there. So Krishna was just indirectly indicating to Balaramji and other gopas that look at this hasya rasa personified. She became beautiful now and she immediately is calling us to his house, to her house. So Krishna just made the whole scene look like a very jovial scene. Actually, when Krishna was proposed by Kubja in a conjugal mood, Krishna felt little uncomfortable because his elder brother Balaramji was right there. In front of Balaramji, Krishna felt little uncomfortable and felt awkward to hear this kind of conjugal proposal from Kubja. So that's why he just managed to make it look like a very jovial thing. But through the same words, Krishna also gave a reassurance to Kubja that I am going to come to your house very soon after killing Kamsa mainly, and I will fulfill your desires. So why this Kubja developed a spontaneous conjugal love for Krishna? Because Kubja has been longing to associate with Krishna in a conjugal mood since long time. Her longing was not a recent thing, not a very spontaneous thing which has taken birth on that spot. Kubja was Surpanakha in her previous birth. As Surpanakha, Surpanakha was the sister of Ravana. Ravana became very lustful and attracted to Sita Devi. Similarly, Surpanakha also became very lustful and attracted to Lord Ramachandra. So Surpanakha came in front of Ramachandra when Lord Ramachandra was in his Vanavas. He was in the forest along with Lakshmana and Sita Devi. And Surpanakha came. She was attracted to Ram. And she said, let's marry. And we want to enjoy together. Then Lord Ram said, I'm already married. So Sita Devi is my wife. And I have taken a vow that I will marry only one woman in my life. Kshatriyas, it is common for Kshatriyas to marry multiple wives. But Lord Ramachandra is ekapatni vrata dharo rajarshi charita hasuti. So in this way, Bhagavatam glorifies Lord Ramachandra as ekapatni vrata dhara. He marries only one woman. So he married Sita Devi and then he said, Surpanakha, I cannot marry you. I cannot stay with you. If at all you want, there is my brother. Now his wife is there in Ayodhya. His wife is not with him. So you can just go and propose to this my Lakshman. My brother Lakshman. And Lakshman said, I am a servant. And if you marry me, you will also become servant. Because I am servant of Ram and Sita. And if you marry me, you will also become servant. So better you go to Ram only. Then Surpanakha again went to Ram. Then Ram also was he was not accepting her proposal. So then Surpanakha felt that this Ram and Lakshman are just playing with me. And the reason is that Sita is present here. So Surpanakha went and attacked Sita Devi. She was about to attack Sita Devi to kill her so that Ram can accept Surpanakha. Then Lakshman came and cut her nose and sent her away. And since then, Surpanakha was burning in her heart with a longing to attain Lord Ramachandra as her husband. She had spontaneously developed conjugal feelings towards Ram, and now that her desire was not fulfilled, she went to a place and she did 5,000 years of tapasya. Sorry, 10,000 years of tapasya she has done. So she worshipped Krishna for 10,000 years. She worshipped Lord Shiva for 10,000 years. And Shiva came in front of Surpanakha and said, "Surpanakha, what is your desire?" And Surpanakha said, "I am actually overwhelmed with an uncontrollable and irresistible desire to have Lord Ramachandra as my husband. Can you please grant me this boon, O Lord Shiva?" Then Shiva said, "Because you are desiring it so much, Krishna will definitely fulfill your desire, but not immediately. So Lord Ram is Ekapatni Vrata, and then he has to be like this only. And in the next life or next incarnation of the Supreme Lord, when he comes as Krishna in Mathura city, your desire will be fulfilled." So Surpanakha was born as Kubja or Trivakra in Mathura city, and Krishna has fulfilled her conjugal desire to have Krishna as her husband. So like that, Krishna fulfilled her desire later after killing Kamsa. So that chapter will come little later. So Krishna just dispatched this Kubja, and then he went little ahead in his tour of Mathura. Then leaving her with these sweet words, Krishna walked further down the road. The merchants along the way worshipped him and his elder brother by presenting various gifts. Even the merchants and other residents of Mathura are also offering so many gifts to Krishna and Balaram. These are like young boys, 10, 11 year old boys. And the sight of Krishna just invoked the influence of Cupid in the hearts of all the women of Mathura. Now, Sukadeva Goswami describes in the 14th shloka of the 42nd chapter of 10th canto. He says, "Taddarshana smarakshobhat atmanam navidan shriyaham visrasta vasah kavaram valaya lehya murtayaham." So all the women of Mathura, especially the younger women who were in conjugal, who developed a conjugal attraction towards Krishna, they, at the sight of Krishna, they were tormented by Cupid. They were overwhelmed with some conjugal feelings, and their clothes and braids and bangles became disheveled, and they stood still like figures in a painting. So they have experienced different effects of Cupid. Whenever somebody is influenced by Cupid or Madana or Kamadev, one is afflicted with lust. It's on a material plane. But when devotees of the Lord, like Mathura Vasis or Dwarka Vasis or Vraja Vasis, when they are attracted to Krishna with a conjugal mood, that is not material lust, that is spiritual love. All the conjugal affairs of Krishna or the Madhurya pastimes of Krishna are transformation of his spiritual energy. So they are spiritual love, they are exchanges of spiritual love. There is no trace of material lust in those exchanges. When these women of Mathura are attracted to Krishna because of the influence of Cupid, it's not that they were tormented by material lust. It's a spiritual attraction towards the Supreme Lord Krishna, and it is natural for every soul to get attracted to Krishna in some mood or the other. Some devotees, some souls are attracted to Krishna with feelings of affection like parents, and some souls are attracted to Krishna with feelings of friendship in Sakhya Rasa, and some souls are attracted to Krishna in the mood of servants like in Dasya Rasa, and some other souls are attracted to Krishna in a Madhurya Rasa or conjugal relationship. So this Sakhya Rasa, Madhurya Rasa, Vatsalya Rasa and Dasya Rasa, these are various rasas in which one can connect with Krishna. So one can be a friend of Krishna, one can be a servant of Krishna, one can be a parent of Krishna, one can be a lover of Krishna. These are various ways in which people get attracted. All these are Krishna prema only, love for Krishna, which is manifested in specific flavor. So these people are attracted, and there are 10 effects of Cupid as discussed in the purport. So whenever somebody is influenced by Cupid, they undergo these 10 stages. So they are Chakshuragaha, Chittasanga, Sankalpa, నిద్రాఛేద తనుత విషయ నివృత్తి త్రపానాశ ఉన్మాద అండ్ మూర్ఛ అండ్ మృతి దీస్ ఆర్ ది 10 ఎఫెక్ట్స్ ఆఫ్ క్యూపిడ్ ఫస్ట్ ఈజ్ చక్షురాగ వెన్ ఎ బాయ్ ఈజ్ అట్రాక్టెడ్ టు ఎ గర్ల్ ఆర్ ఎ గర్ల్ ఈజ్ అట్రాక్టెడ్ టు ఎ బాయ్ దట్ హ్యాపెన్స్ ఫస్ట్ త్రూ ఐస్ ఐ కాంటాక్ట్ సో చక్షురాగ మీన్స్ an attraction developed through seeing the opposite gender because of the influence of cupid or madana or kamadev a boy and a girl are they get attracted to each other by first seeing each other so that is chakshuraga after chakshuraga the next stage second stage is chittasanga means there is an intense attachment that is developed within the mind through the eyes the impressions of seeing the opposite gender will go into the mind and within the mind they develop a deep attachment chakshuraga chittasanga then third effect is sankalpa means one is overwhelmed with a feeling of determination to attain the association of opposite gender first association is through eyes second attachment is in the mind third a great determination to attain that association of the opposite gender boy or girl and nidracheda fourth stage is nidracheda one will lose one's sleep and fifth stage is that tanuta one will become emaciated because of not sleeping properly not eating properly because of always thinking about the opposite gender one can become emaciated very thin and lean that is the fifth stage called tanuta and the sixth stage is vishaya nivritti one will lose interest in all other objects so there is no interest in eating or sleeping or other relationships when one is so much attracted to the boy or girl and seventh stage is trapanasha one could even become shameless one could be shameless in expressing one's conjugal feelings towards the beloved personality in because of the effect of cupid the eighth stage is unmada one could become mad ninth stage is murcha one can faint also out of deep love 10th stage is mriti one could even die out of love or lust lusty attraction towards the opposite gender these are the 10 stages of cupid so when somebody is affected by cupid that person will undergo these 10 stages either boy or girl man or woman but these 10 stages out of these 10 stages the devotees of the lord who are attracted to krishna in conjugal mood experience the first 9 stages the 10th stage of mriti or death will not occur in the case of devotees of krishna but the first 9 stages could occur ultimately a soul is supposed to be helplessly attracted towards krishna only in whichever rasa but a perverted reflection of that topmost attraction between the soul and the supreme soul krishna is the perverted reflection of that relationship is lust in this material world so one has to just stay away from these effects of cupid but one has to cultivate all such attraction and affection for krishna chakshuraga one can see the darshan of krishna one can get attracted to krishna's beautiful form chittasanga one can develop intense attachment towards krishna within one's mind then sankalpa third stage one can be determined to render service to krishna then nidra cheda out of intense feelings of separation from krishna a devotee may not even sleep also then tanuta one can become emaciated and other stages also just come that trapanasha one will lose all interest in other things apart from krishna like that all the stages the first 9 stages can also be experienced by a devotee of krishna the 10th stage will not be experienced so every feeling and every emotion has its place in spiritual life also of course some very deeply negative feelings like envy may not be applicable in spiritual life but generally this love and affection they are all there on the material plane also on a spiritual plane also but as spirit souls as part and parcels of krishna as fragmental parts of krishna as eternal servants of krishna we are supposed to have such loving affectionate feelings towards krishna towards god and his devotees rather than having such relationships and affection towards materialistic people on a material plane we need to see other people as children of god and on that level on a spiritual plane we can have relationships, loving relationships. So the women of Mathura underwent some of the stages of Cupid when they saw Krishna walking on the streets of Mathura. Then Krishna went further in his tour. Then Krishna was inquiring from different people, where is that sacrificial bow? Kamsa has actually planned for a Dhanuryaga, a sacrifice or a celebration that is meant to worship Lord Shiva's bow. So Krishna became very curious to know where is that bow, and he asked different people and reached the place where that bow is displayed. And the bow was so majestic, it was so huge, and Krishna went there. And all Krishna wanted to see that bow very closely. Krishna and Balaram were going closely, and the gopas were accompanying them. And when Krishna was going closely, all the soldiers who were guarding that bow, they told Krishna and Balaram, you are not supposed to come here. They were just trying to push Krishna aside. Then Krishna and Balaram just pushed those guards. So they just kicked them out, and then Krishna just very courageously, very boldly, he went near that bow and he lifted that bow with his left hand. So it's very beautifully described by Sukadeva Goswami. Karena vamena salila mudhratam sajjam chakritva nimishena pashyatam nranam vikrishya prabhabhanja madhyato yathekshudandam madakah yurukramah. Krishna just lifted this bow, this Shiva's bow, with his left hand very effortlessly. That bow is so heavy, and it takes so many hundreds of men to lift that bow, but Krishna effortlessly, just 10-11 year old boy, he just lifted it effortlessly and held it in his left hand, and he stringed the bow and he pulled the string. How effortlessly he has lifted the bow, just like a baby elephant effortlessly picks up a sugar cane. Similarly, Krishna has picked up this bow with his left hand very effortlessly, while the guards were trying to persuade to stop Krishna. So very carelessly, very casually he lifted the bow. Easily lifting the bow with his left hand, Lord Urukrama strung it in a fraction of a second. Stringing such a huge bow will take a while, but Krishna just effortlessly strung the bow and then pulled the string and then released it. And he then powerfully pulled the string and snapped the bow into half. As Krishna powerfully pulled the string and then released it, the bow just the bow broke into two parts. And people just never imagined it, that this boy will just go on the altar and then pick up the bow and then break the bow into two halves. People could never imagine it. Lord Ramachandra has done it before the marriage of before he married Sita Devi. So before marrying Sita Devi, Janaka Maharaj had this Shiva Dhanu, Shiva's bow only in his kingdom, and then Vishwamitra, then Lakshmana were there, and Lord Ramachandra just effortlessly picked up that bow and then made it stand and then string the bow and then pull the string and then effortlessly made the bow into two halves. And then Sita Devi came with a varamala and then offered that garland to Lord Ramachandra. It's a very enchanting pastime in Ramayana. Similarly, Krishna has also broken one bow of Lord Shiva here. And the sacrifice was being conducted to worship this bow, and Krishna has broken that bow only. So Kamsa was so astonished. And when the bow was broken, that sound was so huge, so tumultuous, that it just went in all directions. And Kamsa was sitting in his palace. Kamsa could hear that sound very clearly and loudly, and he was wondering what happened. So it was the sound of breaking of the bow. And the sound of the bow's breaking filled the earth and sky in all directions. Upon seeing it, Kamsa was struck with terror. So Kamsa was already fearful for more than a decade. In fact, he was fearful before Krishna's birth also. Before Krishna's birth, six children died in the hands of Kamsa. Means Kamsa has been in great fear since 16 to 18 years, since the marriage of Devaki till this date, till Krishna became 10-11 years old. Kamsa was absorbed in the remembrance of Krishna in the mood of fear. That also purified him. that made him closer to Krishna. When somebody is absorbed in Krishna, even with a negative feeling also, Krishna is kind enough to accept the remembrance in the devotee's mind and neglect the negative aspect of it. And then when that negative feeling takes a person deeply into absorption of Krishna, then one can get even liberated also. But if one's negative feelings of envy or anger or blasphemous attitude towards Krishna, critical mentality towards Krishna, fall below the standard of absorption, then one will not be liberated. One will go to hell because of sinful activities. So then the gods came and said, kill him, kill him. He has broken our bow. So let's attack him. Then Krishna and Balaram picked up the two halves. The bow has become two. Krishna picked up one half and Balaramji has picked up one half. And they effortlessly started beating the guards and they killed the guards also. So Krishna has killed the washerman. He began his tour by killing the washerman and he ended the tour by killing all the guards who were guarding this Shivadhanu, this bow. Then seeing the guards coming upon them with evil intent, Balaram and Krishna just killed all of them. Then after that, as they strolled about at will, the sun began to set. It was little late in the evening. It was already evening, sunset. So they left the city with the boys and returned to the camp. So Nanda Maharaj and the cowherd men who came from Vrindavan were given some residence there, some accommodation there. So Krishna and Balaram, after touring Mathura city so nicely, they came back and stayed in their camp. And at that time, Sukadeva Goswami speaks a beautiful verse in this context. He says, Gopyo Mukunda Vigame Virahaturaya Asashata Sisharta Madhupurya Bhuvan Sampashyatam Purusha Bhushana Gatra Lakshmim Hitvetarannu Bhajatas Chakameyanam Shrihim. In the previous chapter, if you remember, we have discussed that the gopis of Vrindavan, while singing their Viraha Gita, they said that the dawn of the next day, means the next morning, is very auspicious for the women of Mathura, while it is very inauspicious for the gopis of Vrindavan. Because the gopis of Vrindavan have predicted that women of Mathura will have the fortune of seeing the beautiful form of Krishna the next day, the women of Mathura today got that opportunity. So basically, the prediction of the gopis has become true now, today. So that's what Sukadeva Goswami is saying. In fact, Sukadeva Goswami is also favoring the gopis only. Sukadeva Goswami also did not feel so happy or excited that Krishna left the gopis and then came to Mathura. But it has to be done. So it is a gopis blessing on Mathura Vasis. So he then further shloka. It says that as Krishna and Balaram came back to their camp and they took their meal, because Mother Yashoda has packed some food for their meal that day. So today, that day morning, they started from Vrindavan and somewhere close to evening they came to Mathura, and they had spent that evening in touring the city of Mathura. And in the night they came back to their camp and Mother Yashoda has packed some food for them to eat. That is milk mixed with rice. And Krishna has taken this rice made by Mother Yashoda. And then although knowing that Kamsa intended to kill them, still they spent the night very comfortably. That night was actually a nightmare for Kamsa. Kamsa was so much absorbed in fear all these years, and at this point Kamsa has heard the sound of the breaking of the bow, and his soldiers and ministers informed Kamsa that Kamsa, that boy Krishna who came from village Vrindavan, he has broken your bow. He has broken Lord Shiva's bow. He is so powerful and he has killed our guards also. He has killed your soldiers also. Then Kamsa became extremely anxious about his own death, because the next day morning he is going to die. So Kamsa was anticipating that, what will happen to me? He was so insecure, he was so fearful. but he did not have the humility to surrender at the lotus feet of Krishna. So Kamsa could not sleep that whole night while absorbed in fear of Krishna. And another person also did not sleep the whole night. That was Nanda Maharaj. Nanda Maharaj told Krishna and Balaram, before they were going for a tour, Nanda Maharaj told Krishna and Balaram, "You should not do any mischief. You are very naughty boys. You are doing all mischief in Vrindavan." And that was okay, because it is Vrindavan and all the people there are Vrajavasis. They love you. They had so much affection for you. But Krishna and Balaram, mind you, you have come to city for the first time. So you are not supposed to do any mischief or naughty activities here. So just go see the city and come back as soon as possible without causing any disturbance to anyone in Mathura. We are coming to a foreign place. This is not our village. It is a city. And that too, this is the city of a cruel king named Kamsa. Please don't do any mischief there. So Nanda Maharaj told Krishna and Balaram. But Krishna and Balaram have done exactly the opposite. They just began the tour by killing a washerman. And they did many other things. They reciprocated with the loving affection of so many other Mathura Vasis, including the florist Sudama and the weaver and Kubja and many other women and merchants, Brahmanas, etc. But they ended the tour by breaking the bow of Kamsa and by killing the soldiers of Kamsa. So Nanda Maharaj was so anxious. Kamsa is already cruel and my boys have done such a great mischief. What will happen to Krishna and Balaram? So Nanda Maharaj could not sleep the whole night because of his deep concern for Krishna and Balaram, because of his love for Krishna and Balaram. And Kamsa could not sleep the whole night because of his fear and envy towards Krishna and Balaram. So we cannot sleep properly either out of love for the Lord or out of envy towards the Lord. So which one we can decide? So Kamsa is a person who has fear for Krishna, fear towards Krishna, and then he could not sleep. And whole night Kamsa was seeing so many inauspicious omens. He was seeing so many bad omens. He was terrified thoroughly. And although he could not sleep, he saw so many dreams. He saw so many bad omens which were like messengers of death. Our Sukadeva Goswami describes in 4 shlokas various bad omens that Kamsa has seen during that night. He says, Kamsa looked at his reflection in the mirror, but he could not see his head. So when you look into the mirror, you will see your whole figure, but he could not see his head. If there is no head for Kamsa, Kamsa cannot see anything, but he was able to see things, but he could not see his head. So that's how Kamsa had this kind of nightmares. And for no reason, the moon and stars appeared double. He could see 2 moons in the sky, and he saw a hole in his own shadow. When he saw the shadow, there was a hole in the shadow, and he could not hear the sound of his life air. Trees seemed covered with a golden hue. Like that, so many such very uncommon omens he has seen, and he was absorbed in fear. And the next day morning, lot of preparations started for the Dhanuryaga, and Kamsa, early in the morning, he called for his assistants, and especially he has called for his elephant keeper. The Mahamatra, or the person who takes care of the elephants, the elephant keeper, who especially was taking care of Kuvalaya Pida, he called. So he called this Mahamatra. He is called Mahamatra. So Kamsa was wondering at the feet of Krishna and Balaram in Mathura. And he has been hearing all the wonderful activities that Krishna and Balaram have done in Vrindavan also, all this while. And Kamsa called this Mahamatra and told this elephant keeper, "My dear elephant keeper, so I have a lot of hopes on you. You are taking care of Kovalaya Pida. Tomorrow morning, means today only, means that he to spoke about this, spoke in early in the morning of that same day, on the day where he planned for this Dhanuryaga. So today, you should keep this Kuvalaya Pida and block the entrance of Krishna and Balaram." So Kuvalaya Pida means our elephant should block Krishna. So before even Krishna enters the wrestling arena where I am sitting, you should manage to kill Krishna and Balaram with your Kuvalaya Pida elephant. So actually, I have so many people here in my kingdom and my own family members are there, they are very unfavorable towards me. My father Ugrasena was actually not my father. So he did not have much love and affection for me. And I'm also not getting much favor or support from many other family members that I have. Vasudev, Devaki, and then many Vrishni, Andhaka, Bhujas, all these dynasties are there. Apparently they are all my relatives, but actually they are not my relatives because I am not the son of Ugrasena. So Kamsa came to know from Sis. Kamsa spoke to this Mahamatra that I am not the son of Ugrasena. I am the son of a demon named Drumila. Because once Ugrasena's wife, she was playing with her friends when she was very young, when she was newly married to Ugrasena. And a Drumila, a demon named Drumila, was just passing by in his tours, and he could see this wife of Ugrasena. And then she was so beautiful that Drumila got attracted to her beauty, and he wanted to have a union with her. Then Drumila, if he comes in his form as a demon, very powerful, ferocious demon, then she would be frightened. So Drumila is accustomed to so many mystic powers. So he changed his form into Ugrasena's form. And in the form of Ugrasena, this Drumila came to Kamsa's mother. And then Kamsa's mother, Ugrasena's wife, thought that her husband has come. And she welcomed her husband. And then she treated him with great affection and love, and Drumila enjoyed with her. And after that, Drumila's reality is revealed. Drumila was not Ugrasena, Drumila was a great demon. So this Kamsa's mother could understand that in that way this Drumila impregnated this Ugrasena's wife, and she eventually gave birth to Kamsa, and out of shame she could not also speak this to anyone. And somehow Kamsa was raised as the child of Ugrasena, but he imbibed the qualities of demon Drumila. So this fact was known to Kamsa, and Kamsa revealed this to this elephant keeper, and he told the elephant keeper, so nobody in my family is favorable to me. So I have a lot of hopes on you. You only have to protect me. So please keep your elephant Kavalaya Peda and then kill Krishna before he comes to this wrestling arena. So when Mahamatra heard all the story from Kamsa, he said, don't worry, my dear master. I am your servant. I will do the needful to serve you. I will, with all my might, with all my power, I will certainly have my elephant Kavalaya Peda kill Krishna. Don't worry, you will hear the good news very soon. Like that he very confidently said. And Kamsa then passed orders to different people, and then he went to the wrestling arena to see all the arrangements there. So the wrestling arena is so very well decorated with nice garlands and festoons and other decorations. And Kamsa's dais was in the center of the whole stadium, and then Kamsa's dais was arranged there. And next to Kamsa's dais were like prominent members of this Yadu dynasty, Vrishni dynasty, and so many different sections were made, galleries were made so that common Mathura citizens can sit there and watch the wrestling match. So like that Kamsa was overseeing all these arrangements, and Kamsa sat on the dais as the time to start the wrestling match began. Was coming closer, Kamsa sat on the dais. Kamsa could see that Nanda Maharaj and all the other Gopas also were sitting on the dais. Dais means closer to Kamsa. And so many people have assembled there. And Kamsa even called for Chanura, Mushtika, Shala, Toshala, Kota, all his wrestlers. And everybody was waiting there. But Krishna and Balaram did not come. Because when Nanda Maharaj was leaving his camp, Krishna and Balaram were supposed to go along with Nanda Maharaj, but Krishna and Balaram said, we will go to Yamuna Ghat. We will play there. We will take some bath there, and then we will come. We will directly come to wrestling arena. Nanda Maharaj, you can go ahead. So we will just have some tour and then have some fun. We will go to Yamuna Ghat and then come to wrestling arena. So Nanda Maharaj was waiting for Krishna and Balaram to come. He already reached the wrestling arena, and the king Kamsa is asking for Krishna and Balaram specifically. Till now, Kamsa has not seen them. So then Kamsa told Nanda Maharaj very diplomatically, "Nanda Maharaj, where are your sons? I don't see Krishna and Balaram here. I could see so many of your cowherd men associates, but I don't see Krishna and Balaram. Where are they?" Then Nanda Maharaj innocently said that, "My dear king, Krishna and Balaram were just about to come. So they went to Yamuna Ghat and then they will come here very soon." Then Kamsa diplomatically said, "Nanda Maharaj, don't worry. Yesterday your children have done some mischief in my kingdom. They have broken the bow, and then Krishna has broken the bow, and your both children have killed some of my guards and soldiers also. I don't mind, don't worry. So you should just teach them discipline. They should behave properly. They should not do some mischief like that. But I will not punish them. I will not do anything. You don't worry. So just send your men, send your assistants, and then call them to wrestling arena as early as possible." So like that, Kamsa gave an instruction to Nanda Maharaj. And Nanda Maharaj said, okay, I will send some people. And Nanda Maharaj just was telling to other gopas. Meanwhile, Krishna and Balaram were coming towards the wrestling arena. So as they were coming, this elephant keeper, he has kept Kovalaya Peda blocking the entrance of Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna ordered this person, this Mahamatra, "So why are you blocking our way? Just you should take your elephant, ambashta, ambashta, you just take your elephant and go aside so that we can go on this path." But the Mahamatra did not hear this warning or the request of Krishna. He just said, he just goaded his elephant, and he instigated his elephant Kovalaya Peda to attack Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna saw that Kovalaya Peda was coming to attack him. Krishna ran away, not out of fear. It is Krishna's nature to play for a little while with the demons who are coming to attack him so that he can have some fighting pleasure. So Krishna just attacked this Kovalaya Peda, and Kovalaya Peda was attacking Krishna, and Krishna was running away, giving an opportunity, giving some encouragement to Kovalaya Peda to come and attack Krishna. And Krishna is a small 10-year-old boy, and Kovalaya Peda was a huge elephant. Krishna was sometimes hiding between the legs of Kovalaya Peda without any fear. Who will go under an elephant? Who will go and hide behind the leg of an elephant? But Krishna can do that. Krishna was hiding between the legs of this elephant Kovalaya Peda, and then Kovalaya Peda was frantically searching for Krishna, and then Kovalaya Peda got frustrated, and eventually after fighting with Kovalaya Peda for a long time, so Krishna just stuck Kovalaya Peda. So he held the elephant's tail, and the animal tried to twist away to the left and to the right, making the Lord shiver in the opposite direction, as a young boy would swerve when pulling the calf of the tail of a calf. So just like Krishna has a habit of pulling the tails of calves in Vrindavan, he was pulling the tail of Kovalaya Peda in Mathura. So Krishna fought effortlessly, and Krishna also, before fighting, he just tied his locks of hair with his cloth, so that the beautiful curly hair locks will not cover his face, because when Krishna is killing the demons, demoniac people, while dying, these demons should see the beautiful, charming face of Krishna and then die. So Krishna was thinking that, let my hairs not block my block the vision of my face. Let the demons have a experience of seeing me while dying, so that they could get liberated. So in this way, Krishna just tied his locks of hair, and then he fought with Kovalaya Peda. And after fighting Kovalaya Peda for a while, Krishna killed Kovalaya Peda. So when Kovalaya Peda was killed, this elephant keepers just ran away. There were 7 elephant keepers who were taking care of Kovalaya Peda, and then they ran away. And Krishna, with all the blood on his face, when Krishna killed Kovalaya Peda, so Kovalaya Peda had tusks. So Krishna picked up one tusk, Balaramji picked up one tusk. Just like the previous day, when Krishna broke the bow, the 2 pieces of the bow were taken by Krishna and Balaram, and with those 2 pieces, they killed so many soldiers. Now when Krishna killed Kuvalaya Pida, so Krishna and Balaram took the tusks of this elephant and then they went to the wrestling arena, and some drops of blood and perspiration were decorating the face of Krishna. He was looking so beautiful. In whatever attire, in whatever mood Krishna may be, Krishna is always charming. And who was this Kuvalaya Pida? Kuvalaya Pida, in his previous life, he was the son of Bali Maharaj. His name was Mandagati. So this Mandagati once went to take darshan of the Lord Ranganath in Srirangam temple. So he went to Srirangam, and when he went to Srirangam temple, so he was just throwing people away. He was just moving carelessly, fearlessly. So many people were there, but he was very strong person. He was just moving people, and then he was just without any care or fear, he was just moving ahead. Just as elephant walks on the street, other people have to give way to the elephant. So elephant wouldn't care for anyone. Similarly, this person, huge personality, very powerful personality, he was walking without caring for anyone. A sage named Kusha came there and said, "You are walking like an elephant. You are so proud of your strength. So I curse you to become an elephant. You came to a holy place, you came to a holy temple, and then you have come to, you are disturbing people, you are not caring for people. I curse you to become an elephant." So that Mandagati, the son of Bali, he became an elephant. And in his elephant form, in the next life, he went into the camp of Jarasandha. And Jarasandha was maintaining this elephant Kuvalaya Pida. And once Jarasandha had this camp, and from his camp, this elephant came towards a place where Kamsa was there. So Kamsa just was irritated by this elephant Kuvalaya Pida. And Kamsa was such a powerful personality, he picked up this elephant Kuvalaya Pida and then threw him 80 miles ahead. And then Kamsa, just when he threw Kuvalaya Pida elephant, one elephant Kuvalaya Pida has the strength of thousands of elephants. It's not an ordinary elephant. Jarasandha knew it very well. And Jarasandha saw that Kamsa could effortlessly pick up this Kuvalaya Pida and throw him 80 miles. Means Kamsa is much powerful than Kuvalaya Pida. Who can be more powerful than an elephant? So then Jarasandha was so impressed with Kamsa's power, and he thought that, "Let me give my two daughters in marriage to Kamsa." Thus Kuvalaya Pida became instrumental in the marriage of Kamsa with the two daughters of Jarasandha. So like that, Kamsa married the two daughters of Jarasandha, and as a gift, Jarasandha has given this Kuvalaya Pida to Kamsa. So since then, Kamsa is maintaining Kuvalaya Pida, and today Kamsa wanted Kuvalaya Pida to kill Krishna, but Krishna has killed Kuvalaya Pida. So after killing Kuvalaya Pida and liberating Kuvalaya Pida, so Krishna picked up the tusks along with Balaram and entered the wrestling arena. And after Krishna entered the wrestling arena, he was perceived by all the people of Mathura in the wrestling ring in various ways. So that we will discuss in the next episode. Thank you all very much. Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.